Hello everyone, welcome. My name is Navid, and it's the first time in France that I'm speaking about Python, so God helps you. Okay, so me, in 1 minute or less, I'm a data scientist. I work in TableX, which is a part of Bending Glass. TableX works specifically in Europe, Bending Glass, the rest of the world. So together, we can cover all the job announcements in the world. We capture everything, we analyze everything, and we do lots of stuff with them. I'm also a researcher, computer science researcher in the University of Milan Bicocca. I teach Python in different master courses, and I do research. So, as you can see, I had a bit unusual career path. Let's say I started from design, go to music, astronomy, industrial engineering, management engineering, marketing, smart manufacturing, business intelligence, and research and teaching at the end. So, okay, that's me. Was me. Okay, I think I can't repeat this one, but anyway, go smart. If you want to guess, it seems like it's like a bike sharing or something like that. It's even worse, it's a transit app. But why we need another transit app? Because we have at least twice the number of these things that you can see here. Okay, these are some of applications that I use in daily life to go to work. But why we need them? This is the result of one trip I had to Mantova. You can see that 220 minutes of delay. Okay, and this is this morning with the 1 hour of delay. Hour of delay. So why, if we have all these shiny, fancy, nice applications, and we have Google Maps, for example, why we have these problems? Why we cannot anticipate these problems? Okay, this is how a usual app works. It goes to the company, it takes information from API and gives it back to user. That's it, simple as that. This user asked the app, I want to go from here to there. The same question goes to API, answer user, that's it, more or less. Okay, even Google Maps works like this, more or less. But not GoSmart. GoSmart has a different approach. It means that it starts with an API, of course, information of trains, timetables that only can come from the train company. But it also adds three other things. The first thing is local events. So by scrapping and reading news, local news, it understands that if there is a concert, if there is a football match or something like that, close to certain stations, okay? Or if there will be a strike, or if it wasn't a strike yesterday or the day after that, or accident. And also the last thing that you can see also today exactly is weather. If it's raining, if it's windy, if it's snowy, because you know, having this information changes everything. For example, I think that if it was normal, it was a normal day today, I was here not at 9:45 but like 8:30. I put like 1 hour more just because it was raining. But okay, it happens. It happens everywhere. I guess I was thinking that it happens most of the time in Italy, but I see it's also in France. So, okay, as you can see, the first three things, the information, timetable information, local events and the strikes and stuff, goes to a MongoDB, okay? For those of you that are not familiar with MongoDB and Neo4j, Neo4j. I have two slides, really fast. I'm not in database expert, so I just explain really fast what are those. So we gather everything as documents in MongoDB. Information of whether instead goes are saved as SQL, okay, the normal table table info we have, and then everything goes to Neo4j. All this information are saved as graphs, as we can see in the later slides, goes there, and every time user asks GoSmart, it actually creates a query in Neo4j and gives the answer. Okay, what is Neo4j? Neo4j is a different type of DB. This is a famous example of difference between SQL and Neo4j. To do that, find all direct reports and how many people they manage up to three levels down. If you want to write it in SQL, it's that two pages. Cypher, which is a language used in Neo4j, does it in like four or five lines. It doesn't mean that Neo4j is the answer to everything and works better all the time. It's not like that, because when the nature of your data is tabular, you go for SQL and that's it, okay? But when you are doing such a thing, levels, connections, relationships, these things, then Neo4j is the best. On the other hand, we have MongoDB. MongoDB again is an unstructured or semi-structured database, which again we don't have columns and rows, we have documents, and each document can be different. It can have its own fields, and save different information, and again have a relationship with all the documents using keys. So these were two, let's say, explanations, really brief explanations of Neo4j and MongoDB. Okay, challenges. Let's say I put just one slide here because it's the most important thing for me in this project. That this is, let's say, the map of all the trainings in Italy. There are like more or less 3,000 and 11,000 trips per day. So it's really difficult to even get this information from API, because you expect that, okay, go to API and do query in some way for this train from here to there and get info. It's not like that. If I wish you don't do it never, but if you want to use Trenitalia API, you see that some fields are written in English, some in Italian, some in French also, and some of them has just like codes. You can't understand what is the meaning, so you need to work with the API like that in order to create everything. So it was, let's say, for me, the worst challenge. Okay, this is just a really small example of Lombardia. It's one of the biggest provinces of Italy, and some of connections of some of the stations together. So again, it's a really small part of this whole graph that we created. Okay, so how we actually do it? So that's the thing. Again, user asks the famous question, I want to go from here to there. Okay, we ask the same thing from graph, and graph creates this path between stations, and then for each station it calculates the probability of having delay or cancellation, and putting everything together, again considering the weather, considering the accidents, considering the strikes, considering everything, okay, it calculates this probability and put everything together to give you an answer. So it's not just timetable, sorry, it's not the theoretical time, because okay, that's good, but it's not good. This is the result. If you can see on the left, it's Google Maps. That's for the destination and target. It gives you these paths with the time coming from timetables. On the other hand, GoSmart gives you a probabilistic answer that tells you that today, that is weekend, and it's raining, more or less, Metro has 10 minutes of delay, or Trenitalia has 9 minutes of delay, and knowing those information, now you should have 2 hours and 22 minutes instead of 1 hour and 58 minutes that we listed to you. And yes, that was, let's say, the Go Smart thing. If you have any question, I'm here. Otherwise, thank you.
Can you give us a few details on how you get the weather API? Do you get it from open source?
We mostly steal it from the sites that they are not going to give it to us. But the thing is, it's okay, apart from joking, there are some APIs that give it to you for free. The problem is the frequency that you want. And for example, AccuWeather, if I'm not wrong, and weather.com both give you for some limited period the temperature, but it's not enough. So we usually go at the end to the websites like Trenitalia. They also has this temperature. We take it from there.
Do you have penalization from the fact that you have more connections than what you had from Google Maps, for example? Because I think if you take a train and a bus and another bus and another bus,
okay,
you have more chances that the overall scheme or the
yes.
overall project is going to be, they're going to be a problem and you're going to miss one of the buses. You know?
Sure.
So is there like a penalization in your algorithm that takes into account the number of transport that you're going to take?
Yes, okay, nice question. Yes, it actually considers which method of method of transportation is more popular in that day, in that hour. So it tries to minimize the results. So if you, as you say, if you can take either bus or tram or anything else, it tries to just look at the best things according to the historical data. So and somehow minimize the probability of having a delay.
But what about the number of transitions of transfer?
Okay.
Like if you have 4 means of transportation and you only have one, I think it's better to have the one, even though it might be just 2 minutes late. I don't know.
No. Okay. Yes. It's correct. But okay. Honestly speaking, we don't have specifically implemented something like that, but at the end it will be something, if I'm not wrong, if I get your question correctly. Even in Google Maps, you can tell what is your preferred way. If you want, you prefer to walk or arrive a little bit later, but pay less according to how much you should pay for tickets. So we didn't implement that part yet, but it would be smart to add that one, yeah. Thank you, everyone.